welcome to the next edition of the Briefings Direct Voice of the Customer podcast series. I'm Dana Gardner, Principal Analyst at InterArbor Solutions, your host and moderator for this ongoing discussion on digital transformation success stories. Our next Advanced Automobile Racing Technology Innovation discussion explores the Formula E sport. We'll now learn how data-driven technology and innovation are making electric cars an example for all endeavors where limits are tested and bested. To learn more about the latest in Formula E growth and refinement, please join me in welcoming our guest. We're here with Susie Wolf, Team Principal at Venturi Formula E in Monaco. Welcome to the show, Susie.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
We're delighted you're here. So aside from providing a great viewing and fan experience, what are the primary motivators for Formula E racing? Why did it start at all?
It's a really interesting story because in the end, Formula E is like a startup. We're only in our fifth season, and Formula E and the management of Formula E, they really disrupted the world of motorsport because they brought a new concept of going racing to the table. We race in city centres. That means that the tracks are built up just for one day events, right in the heart of some of the most iconic capitals throughout the world. And because it's built up within a city center, it means it's only a one-day event, which is quite unusual in motorsport. That means you get very limited track time. In the morning, we get up, we test, we go straight into qualifying, and then we race. But it's attracting a new audience because of the fact that people don't need to travel out to a race circuit. They don't need to buy an expensive ticket. It means that the racing comes to the people as opposed to the people going out to see racing. Obviously, the technology is something completely new for people. There are no noises, so all you hear is the whooshing of the cars going past. And it's a showcase for the new technologies which we're all going to see appearing on the road in the next 3 to 5 years. We already see some electrification on the roads, and I think that will just become more and more year on year. And what motorsport is so good at, it's showcasing the technology, it's testing the newest technology. So the automotive industry is going through a massive change in electrification, and motorsport is following suit with Formula E.
Well, it's interesting. I was going to ask you about the noise because I've had the privilege and joy of watching a Formula One event in Monaco years ago, and the noise was a big part of it. Aside from these cars being so quiet, what is also different in terms of electric E-formula race and some of the traditional Formula One types of activities?
Well, like you rightly said, that the noise is the biggest factor, and this is what takes a bit of getting used to, because it's the roaring of the engines which creates the emotion and the passion. And obviously, in the Formula E cars, you're missing any kind of noise. So that definitely takes a bit of getting used to. And even the cars that we're starting to drive on the roads, you know, have a little electric smart, and every time I switch it on, I think, oh, the car's not working, I have a problem. I forget that there is no noise when you switch an electric car on. And also in Formula E, the way the technology is developing, how quickly it's developing, is very clear through the racing. So last season, the drivers had two cars, and they had to switch cars in the middle of the race because the battery wouldn't last long enough for a complete race distance. And now, because the battery technology has advanced so quickly, we're doing one race with one car and one battery. So I think that's really the beauty of what Formula E is. It's showcasing this new technology in electric mobility.
And please tell us about Venturi specifically as a startup and how you became principal. You've been involved with racing for quite some time.
Yeah, well, my background is predominantly in racing. I started racing karts when I was only 8 years old and made it through the ranks as a racing driver all the way to being a test driver in Formula One. And I stepped away and decided to do something completely different and start a second career. I was pretty sure it wouldn't be in motorsport because my husband works in motorsport and I didn't want to work for him and couldn't work against him or didn't want to work against him. So I was very much looking for a different challenge. But the gentleman, our president at Venturi, is a great gentleman called Gilles Do Pastor, and he was a pioneer in electric mobility. He built his first electric car 16 years ago. So he was really one of the first to see the possibilities of using batteries in cars. And he's done a number of land speed records, all electric. So he joined Formula E from the very beginning, realizing what potential it had. And the team is based in Monaco, which is a very small country, like a lot of you know, but has a very rich history in racing because of the Grand Prix. And he had approached me when I was still racing to race for his team in Formula E. And I was one of the cynics that was sure that this Formula E wasn't going to be something for the long term. So I said thank you, but no thank you. But then he contacted me last year and said, look, I think we should work together. I think you would be fantastic running the team. And we very quickly found a great deal to work together. And for me, it was just the perfect challenge. It was a new form of racing. It's not quite as intensive and high level as Formula One. So the perfect step for me into the business and management side of motorsport.
Well, for me, the noise is really not a factor because the geek factor is what gets me jazzed about automobiles. And I don't think I'm alone in that. I love the technology. I love the idea of the tiny refinements that improve things and that interaction between the best of what people can do and what machines can do. So tell us a little bit about the geek factor. What is it that is new and fascinating for you about Formula E cars? And is there a departure really from the refinement that goes on between a motorsport in the traditional sense and the new electric version?
It's a massively different challenge than what we're used to within traditional forms of motorsport, because Formula E, the concept behind Formula E, which has functioned really well, because just for this season as an example, we had 8 races with 8 different winners. And in other categories, for example, Formula One, one of the big disadvantages is that it's dominated by one team right now, and there's only really possibility for 3 teams to win a race. Whereas in Formula E, the concept is different. We as a team, we don't build the car from scratch. So like in a Formula One team, they would be responsible for the design build of their whole car. In Formula E, 80% of the car is standardized. So every team receives the same car up to 80%. The last part is the powertrain, the rear suspension and some of the rear end of the car. But the big challenge within Formula E is software. It's ultimately a software race. Who can develop, upgrade, and react quick enough on the software side? And obviously, as soon as you deal with software, you're dealing with a lot of data. And that's really one of the biggest challenges in Formula E. It's predominantly a software race as opposed to a hardware race, because the hardware is set at the beginning of the season, it's homologated, and it can't be changed. So really the performance differentiators are the software and how quickly you can analyze, use, and really develop your data to enable you to find the weak points and correct them quick enough to bring on-track performance.
Well, it's fascinating to me that this could be the ultimate software development challenge, right? Because that 80-20 rule applies to a lot of software development. The first 80%, fairly straightforward. It's the last 20% that can make or break an endeavor. Tell us a little bit about the real-time aspects. Are you actually refining the software during the race, and how does that possibly happen?
Well, a lot of the preparation work is a big part of a race performance. We have a simulator based back at our factory in Monaco, and that is where the bulk of the preparation work is done. Because we are dealing with only a one-day event, it means that we have to get everything crammed into an 8-hour window, which leaves us very little time between sessions to actually analyze and use the data. So the bulk of the preparation work is done in the simulator back at the factory, and each driver does between 4 to 6 days in a simulator preparing for a race. And that's where we do all of the coding and try to find the most efficient way to get from the start to the finish of the race. And that's where we are really doing the bulk of the, let's say, analytical work, so that when we arrive at the actual race, we're just doing the very fine tweaks. Because the race day is so compact, it really means that you need to be efficient. You need to minimize the errors and maximize the opportunities. And that's something which is hugely challenging. If you would have a team of 200 engineers, it would be doable. But in Formula E regulations, you're limited to 20 people on your technical team on a race day. So that really means that efficiency is of the utmost importance to get performance.
And I'm sure in that simulation and modeling phase that you're leveraging high-performance computing and other technologies, but I'm particularly curious about that real-time aspect with a limit of 20 people and the ability to still make some tweaks, to still make adjustments. How did you start to solve the issues around a real-time, intensive, you know, human factor-limited environment like that?
Well, first of all, it's about getting the right people on board and being able to work with the right people to make sure that we have the know-how in the team. And, you know, the data is real-time. So in a race situation, we are aware if there's a problem starting to arise in the car. It's very much up to the driver to control that themselves from within the car, because they have a lot of the controls and the let's say, the very important data numbers on their steering wheel. So they can have the ability to change settings within the car. And that also what makes it massively challenging for the drivers. It's not just about how fast you can go, but it's also how much extra capacity you have to actually manage your car and your battery to make sure that you're being efficient. But the data is of utmost importance of how it's created and then how quickly it can be analyzed and then used to help performance. And that's something which HPE has been a huge benefit to us, because first of all, they've been able to increase the speed at which we can send data from factory to racetrack between engineers. It's increased the level of our simulator and what it's able to crunch through in the preparation work. And this is just the start of the process. So we are obviously looking at all the different areas where we can start, because we have the ability to now crunch through the numbers quicker. It allows us to really look at every different aspect, and it will all come down to marginal gains in the end.
And given that this is a team sport on many levels, obviously you're working with a number of technology partners. What do you look for in a technology partner that might be different for an extreme sport like this than, say, an average business IT environment? Is there something specific about the partners that you look for?
Absolutely. I mean, when you're in a sport, you can very quickly realize if you're doing a good job or not, because every second weekend you go racing and the results are shown on track. And it's very brutal, because if you're at the top step of the podium, you've done a great job. If you're at the end, you need to do a better job. And that's a reality check which we get every time we go racing. For us to be the best, we need to work with the best. And we obviously am very keen to always work with the best in field, but also the companies which are able to identify the exact needs that we have and build a product or a package which helps us. And it's very, within motorsport, it's very specific. It's not like a normal IT company or a normal business where you can plug in and play. It's very, let's say, defined as to what we can do and what will bring performance. So we need to work with companies that are agile. Ideally, they have experience within motorsport, so they know what you need and they're able to deliver, and they're able to also know what's not needed, because there's so many possibilities out there. But in motorsport, everything is very time sensitive, and we need to make sure that we're working on the areas that bring performance and not wasting resource and time in areas which ultimately not going to help our on-track performance.
So it really sounds like efficiency is the key word across all of the life cycle of this development and the sport itself, and then the refinement and review of the analytics. And that's interesting to me, because a lot of times we think about motorsports and it's about eking out the most performance and eking out the highest numbers when it comes to the skid pad and the amount of friction versus the amount of acceleration and so forth. But to me now, understanding this better, I can see that this is about the interplay between the driver and the electricity and the performance and the efficiency. Is there something that we can learn and take from Formula E and apply back to the more general electric automobile industry? It seems to me that they're also fighting the battle to make the batteries last longer, the performance be so efficient that every electron is used properly.
Absolutely, and that's why we have so many manufacturers in Formula E. I mean, we have next season there'll be 12 teams, of which 10 are manufacturers with their own teams, and that's the biggest names in the industry, like BMW, Audi, Mercedes, Porsche, Jaguar. They're all in Formula E because they're all using it as a platform to research and develop and showcase what their technology is. And there are huge sums of money being spent within the automotive industry just now, because there is such a race on to get the right technology in the next generation of electric cars, because the technology is advancing so quickly. And the beauty of Formula E is that we're at the very pinnacle of that. So we are purely performance-based, and it means that those race cars and those powertrains need to be the most efficient but the quickest. And so all of the technology and everything that's learned from the manufacturers doing Formula E eventually filters back into their organizations and helps them to understand where they can improve and what the main challenges are of the electrification and electric mobility in the end.
All right, one last area before we sign off. It seems to me that there's also an auspicious timing element here, that you're pursuing the refinement and optimization of electric motorsports at the same time that artificial intelligence and machine learning technologies are becoming more pervasive, more accessible, brought right to the very edge. Is there an opportunity for you to also highlight the use of such technologies as machine learning and AI, and maybe start to have the machines infer what should be happening next rather than just people analyzing data? Is there a new chapter, if you will, in how AI can come to bear on your quest for the best?
There's absolutely a new chapter, which is just beginning. And certainly in some of the conversations which we've had with our partners, and particularly HPE, for me, it's like opening up a treasure chest, because the one thing we're very good at in motorsport is generating lots of data. The one thing that we are poor at, and it's purely down to manpower and time and resource, is the analyzing of the data, because there's only so much that we have capacity for. And in AI, there's a couple of examples, which I wouldn't even want to share because I wouldn't want my competitors to know what's possible. But there's a couple of examples where we've seen that artificial intelligence can crunch through the numbers in a matter of seconds and spit out the results, which would take us, I can't even comprehend how long it would take us to get to those numbers. But that's a clear example of how much AI is going to accelerate our learning on the data side. And particularly because it's a software race and there's so much analyzing of the data needed to bring performance, this is where for us it's going to be a game changer. And we're only at the start of it. So for us, that's why it's incredibly exciting, but also so important to make sure that we're getting it right, because there is so much possibility that if we don't get it right, there's also big areas that we could end up losing on.
Yeah, you know, maybe people as spectators would not only be watching the cars and how fast they're going, but perhaps there's a dashboard that would provide the feedback in the AI environment, right? A whole new type of viewer experience when you're looking at what the AI can do as well as the car. Whoever thought that AI would be a spectator sport?
Yeah. It's not far away. It's very exciting to think that could be coming.
I'm afraid we'll have to leave it there. We've been discussing how data-driven technology and innovation are making Formula One racing an example for all endeavors where limits are tested and bested. So please join me in thanking our guest. We've been here with Susie Wolf, team principal at Venturi Formula E, based in Monaco. Thank you so much, Susie.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
And a big thank you to our audience as well for joining us for this Briefings Direct Voice of the Customer Digital Transformation Success Story. I'm Dana Gardner, Principal Analyst at InterArbor Solutions, your host for this ongoing series of Hewlett-Packard Enterprise-sponsored interviews. Thanks again for listening. Please pass this along to your IT community, and do come back next time.